myself, Dr. Schuler, who unfortunately could not be here due to a death in his family, but he sends his best to all, Dave Claypool, the principal at Wheaton Warrenville South High School, and everyone in District 200, I want to thank you for being here. This is a wonderful experience that our students have been able to enjoy here at Wheaton North and at Wheaton Warrenville South. There are two things that really stand out. One, our students were able to learn in a setting and they could do it through trial and error. They got immediate feedback as to what they were doing well and what they needed to work on. That's vital for learning to happen. And it was through trial and error. And it was led by our teachers, and it was led by our coaches and our mentors who created an environment for that to happen. There is another point that really stands out. For the first time, I think, in my 18 years in the district, we have really worked and been able to forge a new partnership with community leaders who are not only helping our students, but helping our school. So it is wonderful to have your voice. I'd like you to give them a big round of applause, our coaches and our mentors. We have three teams from Wheaton Warrenville South and two teams from Wheaton North, and we are looking forward to hearing their pitches. We want to thank them for their hard work, because that's why we're here, because of our students. So we wish you the best, and with that, I'm going to hand it over to Mr. Dan Kornteiner.
Thank you, Mr. Bishop. My name is Dan Kornteiner. I'm the Director of High School Instruction for District 200. Thank you for being here tonight. We're going to have a lot of fun. Here's some great ideas from our students at Wheaton North and Wheaton Warrenville South, and we even have students from Edison Middle School, so we're thrilled to have those folks here. When we started to talk about this course, we had conversations, and we were really kind of concerned because there's just not enough ways for us to express a good North-South rivalry around here. So we thought, you know, that rivalry just doesn't seem to be strong enough. Can we find another way to kind of get that going? So we decided, you know, maybe we can have a business pitch competition. So we'll have fun doing that here tonight as well. Before we get started with the pitches, we're going to say thank you to a lot of people, and we want to start with our sharks here, so I'm going to have them quickly introduce themselves so you know who those folks are.
Hi, my name is Jay Haas. I'm with Transnational Payments. We're a payment technology company headquartered in Rosemont.
Good evening. I'm Suzanne Royer, and I'm with Northwestern Medicine.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Tammy Presley. I direct Community and Government Affairs for Northwestern Medicine.
Hello, everyone. My name is Peter Spotch. I am a Senior Vice President with Cantor Fitzgerald out of New York.
My name is Don Longacre. I'm retired from the newspaper industry, and I'm delighted to work on the incubator program.
Hi, I'm Rob Christensen. I'm in cybersecurity sales with a company called Fortinet.
Hi, I'm Paul Dato. I have a financial service company here in Wheaton.
Hi, I'm Jeff Walter. I'm the executive director of account management and planning at an advertising agency in Naperville called Rain Kaiser.
Hi, I'm Tim Traxinger. I'm with a company called Magenium Solutions, and we're just real excited to be here.
All right, thanks to all our sharks. Round of applause for those guys. We would, like Mr. Biscuit mentioned, we've established a lot of partnerships through this process, and so we'll be thanking those folks and recognizing them. We want to start with a group that's been especially influential in this project, and we're going to bring Mr. Don Longacre over, and he's going to talk a little bit about the Student Excellence Foundation.
Thank you. I want to welcome you to the Shark Pitch Night tonight, or as I like to call it, Wheaton's own Shark Tank. This culminates two semesters of work with our high school students. My name is Don Longacre, and I'm the community coordinator, which means that I'm the guy that's done a lot of interfacing with people to get volunteers to help with this project. And also, I help by being one of these sharks tonight. I'm also on the board for the Student Excellence Foundation for District 200, and we're very proud to have been a part of this endeavor. It's been a great project that the Student Excellence Foundation has found very, very personal and very involved. Not every student will start a business, but the exposure to what is necessary includes a great variety of skills, one of which, for example, is budgeting. And how many of your kids have a budget? Well, let me say something else. How many of you have a budget? Well, it's one thing that's taught in this course, among many, many other things, as you can imagine, in trying to start a business. The Student Excellence Foundation's role, we're going to have some slides. The Student Excellence Foundation's role has been to make a major commitment to the program in several ways. First of all, the foundation has made a substantial financial contribution along with our sponsors that are noted in the program. And this funded two classrooms being outfitted specifically for this different type of teaching, collaborative teaching, instead of the traditional teaching of memorizing facts. Second, the foundation has helped to create a sense of excitement by supporting and promoting the program, both internally and externally, to all of the thousands of contacts that we have with the Student Excellence Foundation. Third, the foundation has assisted me as the community coordinator in helping find nearly 100 volunteers. Think about that, 100 volunteers to be on the board of advisors or to be mentors and coaches that co-teach and support our teachers in the classroom. Most every school district in the suburbs has a foundation, and we are the one foundation in District 200. We need your help and involvement, so here are some of the ways that you can help. I'll stand out of the way a little bit. Thanks to foundation donors, this year, in the last 4 years, we've raised $250,000 that have funded grants and to support new initiatives like the Business Incubator Program. If you would like some more information, if you exit through this door on the right, my right, your left, there's a table out front that has a lot of material about the Student Excellence Foundation. Careers in technology continue to evolve. New teaching methods help our schools prepare students for success in this competitive and global workforce. The demand for innovative teaching beyond the standard curriculum continues to grow exponentially. 65% of today's grade school students will hold jobs that do not exist now, and they'll use technologies that have not yet been invented, and they will find solutions to problems that have not yet been found. While none of us can anticipate these changes, we can empower our students to be prepared to think by providing them with access to the latest teaching methods, resources, and materials. Congratulations to the Business Incubator Class of 2018 and to the district administrators, the educators, the volunteers, the sponsors, and in particular to the five finalist teams who are presenting their pitch tonight. Thank you.
As Don mentioned, we rely heavily on our mentors and coaches. We want to make sure we thank those folks. I know a lot of them are here. If you're a mentor or a coach, would you please stand just for a second so we can thank you? Thank you. There are two other people we want to thank before our first pitch, and they're sitting up close. Mr. Tim Brilka and Mr. Greg Crispin are two incubator teachers, Mr. Brilka at South and Mr. Crispin at North. They've done an unbelievably great job this first year, coordinating those coaches and those mentors, encouraging their students, learning a new curriculum. The list goes on and on. So if you guys don't mind standing real quick, we'll thank you for everything you've done. Enough talk, let's get to the pitches. We've got an exciting group here for you. We're going to start off with a group from South, Marketing Mongoose. Come on up.
Per day do you use a napkin? We got lunch, we got breakfast, we got dinner. Three times. In the U.S., over 450 million napkins are used every single day. At Marketing Mongoose, we saw this as an opportunity to revolutionize advertising. We saw that we could take these napkins and turn them into mini billboards. 450 million mini billboards circulating through the U.S. would be priceless for marketing. So, right here we have our examples. I'll give each one to the sharks. So with the napkins, we have an ad on them and then a QR code. So company logo, QR code. This will take you to the coupon of the business. I'll hand them around. If you scan the napkins, it will take you to our presentation. So you can follow our presentation, see how the QR code works. So we'll start off with our team. I'm Connor Burns, the CEO. I'm a senior at Wheatonville South, and I will be attending the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign next year.
I'm Nikhil Tank. I'm a senior. I'm the CFO of Marketing Mongoose, and I will be attending Indiana University next year.
I'm John Keyes. I'm the CFO. I'm a senior. I'll be attending Southern Illinois University next year.
We also have two more members, Joe Adamick and Kendall Simpson. They had a playoff baseball game, and they will be coming later to answer any questions you may have. So to start off our mission statement, so at Marketing Mongoose, we are here to create simple and affordable advertising.
Some of the milestones that we've gone through, back in August, we became a team, and then in October, we came up with the idea of Marketing Mongoose. And then into January, we had our first surveys and initial reactions to our product. And then in February, we got funding for our MVP. And then tonight, the pitch night.
So, the problem. Advertising to a very a specific market segment has become very difficult. There's online ads and things, but advertising is becoming very oversaturated. You have mass email campaigns and other just banners online. But the issue with that is if a consumer sees the ad, they can just click X and it goes away. To fix that, we'll show that on the next slide, but our customer segments, we have businesses and schools with their napkins. We plan on partnering with small businesses to get started, like Arrowhead and other businesses. And with the napkins, we will put them in District 200 school cafeterias and other places. So our solution to the oversaturation of marketing is advertising on napkins. So as you can see on the napkin, there is the QR code and the logo. So for example, so for this one, this would be, if we had the napkin, there's no picture of it here, but there would be a QR code of Arrowhead, or a logo of Arrowhead and a QR code. You'd scan the QR code and it would take you to the coupon right there. So that's what the consumer would see. And we offer real-time stats, as you can see how many scans you get per napkin, run. And the napkins will be noticed by customers because they're in the customer's hand and they can't click X for it to go away. It's right there on like an ad on Facebook or something. You can't click X and have it go away. It's right there in your hands. You have to see it. And while you're eating, you're wiping your face with it, you will see it.
So our technology, again, we take napkins, which you use in everyday life, you see them every day, you wipe your face with them, and we take advertising, which is an oversaturated market, we take the QR code and we mix them all together, shake it up in a little box, and give it to you in a little package with a coupon. And so how it works, the business provides the coupon and we create the QR code on the napkin, we print it on the napkin or stick it on the napkin ourselves. We then supply the napkin to District 200 school for free, and the students can scan the napkin at lunch or after school, wherever they find the napkin. And then after school or whenever they want, they can redeem the coupon at the business. So our competition, as of right now, we have no direct competition. That means we have a monopoly. But our indirect competition would be Cupad, which is advertising on coffee cups, and it doesn't have that big of a market because it's only towards like coffee stands and small coffee stands. We're more towards the bigger picture of schools and events. And then there's also Zazzle, which is custom printing on napkins, and they don't really have the same solution as we do. They just do parties and events.
For our MVP, we partnered with the company Midwest Performance and Strength. And here's actually a copy of our MVP. I only have one, so you have to pass it around. When we did our MVP, we ended up with 20 scans, which is 4% of how many napkins we put out. And we think we can make this number bigger by raising awareness. When we did our MVP, we didn't really explain to the students how it worked. We just wanted to see what they would react, how they react to it. And we also think that gyms are not necessarily the best thing for high schoolers to, that they want coupons or discounts on. But we think that if we put like fast food coupons on in the schools, they would be more interested in it. And not everyone also knows how to use a QR code, so we have to inform people on how that works.
This also is a very good turnout. So with 500 napkins, we got 20 scans, which comes out to 4%. After some research, we found out that for a mail-out campaign, a good return on how many you send out is 0.5% to 2%. So this 4% is actually a very, very good number for the return. And also, if you do a mass email campaign, you should expect even less than that, about 0.5%. So that's this 4% is very good. And you don't know, these 4% of people could be, because there's the 80-20 rule where 20% of your customers will make up 80% of your revenue, and these 4% could have a big impact on your business.
So for our TAM, we have 3,250,000, and then our SAM is 1,625,000. That's for Illinois, and the SAM is 80% of all public and private high schools in Illinois. And our projected TAM is 310,000 and 250,000 for DuPage County. And again, the SAM is 80% of all public and private high schools in DuPage County. For our market structure, it will be $300 for 1 week of advertising with our product. There are 37 weeks in a District 200 school year, and that means we get $11,100 per year if we advertise for all 37 weeks.
Each run also consists of 6,000 napkins in the cafeteria, so the $300 would pay for 6,000 napkins to be placed in the cafeteria. And this would be free for the schools. The schools are saving money. It's just the business would be paying us, and then the school is getting free napkins in return.
Now, if we look at a company like Chick-fil-A, they spend $63 million per year on advertising, and they're only 22nd in the nation, so that means there's 21 other companies above them that spend more than $63 million on advertising. We spend 0.017% of that, of their budget on just advertising, and we get that in, and we feel like we're more effective than a billboard on the highway.
Our product costs 5 cents to make per napkin and sticker the way we make it right now, but it would cost 5 cents for it to be per napkin. It's 5 cents, but it costs 2 cents to make, 1 cent for the napkin and 1 for the sticker. So our gross margin would be 3%, 3 cents, and then our gross margin is 60%. Our revenue growth would be 20% per year. And we would do this by doing free trial runs for companies just to get them to see how like it is, and then to also advertise on media, like social media and stuff.
Funding time. So we are asking for an equity stake of $22,000 for a 10% stake in our company, and this will grant us the ability to print on our napkins as the sharks. You see the napkins there have a sticker on them, but with this money, we'd be able to print directly on them. $15,000 of this cash would be going toward a commercial-grade printer to print on the napkins, and they can, the printer can churn out 2,000 napkins per hour, so this would allow us to print directly on the napkin and be much more appealing to the consumer and the businesses. We are also asking for a $15,000 line of credit just to pay for the napkin, the physical napkin, and for the ink. And we have $2,000 used of the $22,000 to be used for free trial runs for businesses so that they can see the value that we provide to them. So our exit strategy would be in 5 years, we would sell to a major marketing firm such as DDB or any of these other ones.
Our return on investment after 5 years, thinking that we would grow 20% each year, would be about $54,000 after your $37,000 investment.
So why now? With the oversaturation of advertising in the market, it's time to return to its printed roots. We also have a $300 commitment from Arrowhead to fund napkins at Wheaton Brewfest on August 4th. So that is a very good opportunity right there, and it shows that people want to find a new way to advertise. With the oversaturation of just emails, everything is digital. We want to take marketing back to its printed roots. So help us as we change advertising one napkin at a time. Question time.
I have a question. It's actually a two-part question. One is, have you tried to print on a napkin?
We have, but with a residential printer, just like an HP one or something, you cannot, that doesn't feed the napkin correctly. Yeah, it jams the printer. So that's the one the commercial one would be for.
Okay, so at this point, you're going with a label on the napkin?
Well, we have, yes, but we haven't quoted for, if we want to get them printed, for 500 printed napkins, we got it quoted at FedEx for 25 cents per napkin, which is clearly too much for what we're trying to do. We're trying to keep the cost down low to be attractive to the businesses.
And then how many businesses on each napkin?
We have one, most of it, we could do two. We just want to not be competing, so it wouldn't be like Chick-fil-A and PDQ, but we could do, if we were having the napkins that, let's say, we plan to expand to the United Center and other places, so if we did it there, we could do two on there. It'd be like Dick's Sporting Goods and Chick-fil-A, so it'd be two people in different market segments.
How easy was it to win the business with Arrowhead? It seems like that happened a little later in the process. Did they commit with much objection, or was that pretty easy?
Arrowhead was very thoughtful and very kind with us. They really wanted to help us with our idea. They seemed very enthusiastic, and we just went to them. We told them about our idea. We told them what we wanted to do, and they were on board.
We had a conference call with them and explained the whole business, and they were all on board with it.
You know, you said when you did some surveys, or when you were initially doing some surveys, did you reach out to some of the fast food places? Because I know you said the gyms really weren't giving you a lot of response, but some of the local fast food places?
When we did the surveys, we mostly focused on like the people that would be like seeing the advertisement to see if they'd actually use it. But then we also like reached out and called fast food restaurants, and they seemed pretty interested in it.
Yeah, we're in talk with a Chipotle right now. They were going to be on board for the Cinco de Mayo cornhole at Wheaton South, but they didn't get us the coupon in time. So we're still in works with them for doing a different run at a different time.
In the process of selling your business, what do you believe that the value of your business would be to the end user who would buy your business from you?
Well, we see this as just a unique way to change advertising, because everything is just social media, and it's oversaturated. Like if you're on Facebook, you have an ad on the side, banner here, banner here. So if you're going out to eat, you have an ad right there. You're going to see it. You're forced to see it all dinner long. So it's just a different way to get an ad to someone will draw their attention differently. It's just expanding marketing.
It's also somewhat enjoyable because you get something out of it. It's not like you just look at the banner and you say, ugh, I don't want to see that. You see the coupon as well, and you get something out of the advertisement.
I'm just curious about something. You mentioned that you would distribute primarily in schools, right? So did you ask the fast food purveyors how large of a market segment that is for them? How attractive is that teen customer?
We have not, but when we talk to PDQ and Chick-fil-A, they all have been on board to try and get into the high schools, especially Chipotle, because they were trying to push their new queso. So they saw that as a great opportunity to push their queso dip with high school students. So, and high school students have a lot of expendable income from their parents, so.
They sure do. I have a very quick question. So when you scan the code, does it then say you lose the napkin? Is that stick? Do you do a screenshot of that coupon? How does that remain on your phone for you to use in case you don't have the napkin with you later?
Well, it pulls up a PDF in your Safari, so as long as you don't click X on that, it would keep the app.
So that's
for you.
How it stays on.
Yes, or you could screenshot it and show it to the company, but it's, yeah.
Okay.
So one question I had was, have you given any thought to additional metrics or data capture? So if I scan that QR code, are you going to be able to maybe capture a little bit more information about me and be able to use that further in your marketing?
As of right now, we have a tracking software on the QR code, so we see like who does it and location and when, but we don't have like the in-depth stuff like who they are or how old they are and stuff like that, but we have the basic tracking. We can pull up the MVP.
One last thing. So on here, this can show you, this is from the website we use for tracking right there. So that can, it tells you that the time, and then you can get more detailed in the location of when it happens. So if you do a run a certain date, you can see if the napkins are all being used that day, or you can see the exact time of usage.
And this is between 8 a.m. and 2 p.m.
Is that, just real quick, is that when the QR code is scanned, or is that when the coupon is redeemed?
That is when the QR code is open to the coupon. So when the coupon is visible to the consumer, it shows it on there.
Okay.
Thank you for your time.
Great job. You heard it here first. New queso at Chipotle. Insider information. Okay, before we get to the next group, we want to take a quick moment and thank some of our sponsors. We had a lot of different groups come together to help us put on this event. We're real grateful for them. Olive Garden, I hope maybe you smelled some of the food when you came in. Olive Garden sponsored a meal for our students here today. There's probably leftover breadsticks. Go out and help yourself during intermission. National Furniture, we have established a real good relationship with. National Furniture donated some different soft seating and things like that to Wheaton, Warrenville South. One of their sales representatives lives on the south side, and his students or his children went to Wheaton, Warrenville South, so they've helped us quite a bit. All the students who pitch here tonight are going to receive an Incubator t-shirt, and Squeegee Brothers worked with us. They gave us a nice little break for a little advertising space, so that's a fair trade. So we're thankful to Squeegee Brothers for that. The Coleman Foundation is an organization that provides grants for business incubator projects just like this. And they provided us a very generous grant that we will use to purchase some furniture. And then Allegra, you may see some pictures later on or during the intermission. There's some signage in the classrooms that looks really sharp. The owner of Allegra in Romeoville is a Wheaton Central alum, and he helped us with that. So we're real fortunate to have such great community partners. So make sure you, if you visit those places or consider those folks next time you're looking for something. Northwestern Medicine, we have two of our sharks are from Northwestern Medicine. So we're grateful for that partnership. The Wheaton Chamber of Commerce is one of our prize sponsors. So we're grateful to them. Same thing with the Rotary Club of Wheaton. Both the Chamber of Commerce and the Rotary Club have also helped us find coaches and mentors and different volunteers. So that's been a great thing for both Wheaton North and Wheaton Warrenville South. And then you heard from Mr. Longacre and the Student Excellence Foundation. They've been instrumental in helping the program run in its first year. So thanks to all our sponsors. We really appreciate that. All right, we've got another group that's going to come up here in just a moment. Our teams are competing. We have five high school teams that are competing for three prizes. And each of the student winners is going to receive $100 cash for doing a homework assignment. Pretty good deal. All right. Our Sharks have a tough decision to make, too, because they'll also be awarding some money for these teams to keep their business running. So our grand prize winner could win or could receive up to $2,500 seed money for their company. And we have a kind of a second place winner. They could receive up to $1,000 in seed money for their business idea. So a lot to be determined yet. We've heard from one group. Let's bring up the next group. It's Andrew, Chris, John, and Matt.
And Drinkster, come on up.
Iced coffee, doesn't really matter, the choice is yours. You already know that hot coffee is eventually going to get cold, and that iced coffee is eventually going to get warm and melted down. What are you going to do? You're either going to have to drink that product, throw it away, or go back and buy a new one. That's wasteful. That's just cash in the trash. Well, our product, the Drinkster, is here to solve all your beverage blunders. So our problem started with my friend Chris over here. Chris was working a long day during the summer and decided after work he was going to pick up a Frosty from Wendy's. Well, on the way home, Chris's Frosty melted due to the summer heat. Unfortunately, that Frosty had no way of keeping cold due to the fact it was more of a shake than a liquid, so he couldn't transfer it to another container to keep it warm. So we took that idea and applied it to our product, the Drinkster. Our solution is a high-quality insulated sleeve that doesn't require the transfer of liquids and can fit numerous sized drinks. It incorporates an elastic design that can fit almost cup from small Starbucks cups to large Starbucks cups. It doesn't matter, the Drinkster can fit it. The Drinkster also incorporates NASA-grade insulation called aerogel, which is currently in use in the Mars rovers. The aerogel, incorporated with another insulator called Mylar, is used to keep either your hot drinks hot for longer or your cold drinks colder for longer. There's a picture of the Drinkster right there. Along with the Drinkster, we designed a landing page that has pricing info, contact information for us, a video, and a survey that allows people to contact us with information that they may have about the Drinkster and also answer a few questions about the Drinkster. In the future, we look to incorporate a website shop that allows people to order the Drinkster online. And here we will show you our video.
Has this ever happened to you? You stop on your way to work to pick up a beverage to quench your thirst, whether it be hot or cold. Once you purchase your beverage, you realize, oh, my coffee's too hot, or I want to save my iced coffee for when I'm in traffic, and you head off to work. Distracted with traffic or driving, you soon realize your coffee has gone cold, or the ice has melted in your iced coffee, making it watery and lukewarm. That's just cash in the trash. Well, your days of beverage blunders are over with the new product to revolutionize your car's cup holder, the Drinkster.
There we go. Along with our video, we also put out customer surveys and received over 100 responses. With our surveys from watching the video and basically hearing about our product, we proved our concept that people are interested in a sleeve that keeps their beverage cold for longer. Along with these customer surveys, we found out that people were more angered when their iced coffee melted due to the fact that iced coffee cannot really be refrozen on the go, and that when the ice melts in iced coffee, it waters down your drink, ruining the flavor. We also decided that people liked a sleeve idea more than an insulated cup holder, which was our original idea. So we decided to switch to the sleeve idea.
All right, the customer that we'll be targeting and we'll be marketing to is ideally a deluxe drinker. What we mean by this is anybody that's going to stop at a Starbucks or Dunkin' Donuts and buy a drink there, maybe on their way to work or on their way to whatever they need to be going to. So this is primarily commuters, or people that are incapable of reheating their drink and don't have a microwave readily accessible. So because our product fits a cup, we're just targeting people going, picking up the drink, putting the Drinkster on, and keeping it going. This also includes travelers in airports to keep their drink insulated there. All right, so our market size, these are numbers for our TAM, SAM, and our first year customers. in the amount of customers, and I'll go through those more specifically. So our TAM, we took the proportion of people who can drive in the U.S. times the proportion of people that drink coffee or tea regularly times the proportion of people that go out and will buy their drink, and that came out to about 116 million. And then our SAM, we zoomed in just on the Chicago area, and we multiplied by the same proportion of the people that drink coffee or tea and our luxury drinkers centered around the commuters in Chicago. Now, for our market size for our first-year customers, we are targeting the Chicago commuters, and we estimate that our marketing campaign will reach 50% of them, and hoping that 28% of the people that see our ads buy Drinkster, our customers in the first year, is about 50,000. All right, so our competitors right now are Yeti or Swell, which are popular drink insulators out on the market, but they are typically to insulate drinks that you would make at home and have time to pour into a Yeti. We're targeting more people that would get an existing cup and to insulate that cup. There are also koozies, which don't insulate your drink. A product called the Drink Docker, which does fit in your cup holder, but you have to wash it a lot of times. And then a Joe Jack is the closest thing that we could find to our product, which is a neoprene sleeve that fits around a cup.
All right, our minimum viable product. So with our own money, we created a landing page. Our website, it does a survey. People can answer survey questions and also put their email address in, and we can send them info. And we also have a host for our landing page and a logo we paid for. And then with our money that we requested in February, we created our prototype, which you have before you right now. We decided that after we made our prototype, we should test it out before we come here tonight and ask for more money. So what we did is we put one cup with a Drinkster on it and one cup without it. We measured the temperature every couple of hours. And the data with the hot coffee, it stayed 13% warmer per hour with the Drinkster than without it. And this is using the one we created, so it's pretty low budget. And it's the one we created with our sewing machines in our own basements. So it's not the best quality, but it still proved that it worked. And here's a graph that shows the temperature with the Drinkster and the temperature without the Drinkster. Our goal, if you were to receive money tonight, would be to expand the distance between the lines to prove that the Drinkster will keep the drinks hotter for a longer period of time. We also tested with iced tea, which proved to do the same amount of temperature cooling over the same period of time. And here's the graph for the iced tea. Obviously, we'd like to increase the distance between these two lines too.
And then for our numbers, our COGS, we are planning on selling the Drinkster for $15 retail. So to make the Drinkster, originally when we pitched to you guys back in January, our materials per product cost $10.79, which is very expensive compared that we would only sell it for $15. But since then, based on our predictions over this next year, we'd be able to bring that down to $3.70, which is over a $7 decrease. Working with our mentor, Clay Graham, he was able to give us estimates on manufacturing costs, which would be about $3.30 in the first year. So the total would be $6 per Drinkster in year one. And then obviously as production goes up, cost is going to go down. So in year two, we estimated it would be about $5.50, and year three, about $5. Our SG&A, since three of us up here are going to college next year, not in the Chicagoland area, and we are targeting people in the Chicagoland area, Matt can't do that all by himself, so we factored in two salaries of people working part-time, about 20 hours a week at $15 an hour. Also marketing, we are looking at social media and using humor like you saw in our video. So pay-per-click ads on Instagram can get pretty expensive since if someone clicks on the ad, and we automatically get charged even if they don't buy a Drinkster. So we would look to target influencers, who are people who post normally would be drinks like coffee or tea or like to post artsy photos of their drinks and pay them $50 to $100 each depending on their following base as well as give them a free Drinkster. The insurance is another estimate since there's always seems to be problem with coffee, whether it be like that McDonald's scandal where the lady sued for hot coffee on her lap, so we don't want to have any problems with that. So it's an estimate of about 26 cents per $100 in retail sales is what we found. So based off of our year one numbers, that would be about $600 in the first year. Our website cost $300 in the first year as well, since it's not going to be as advanced as it will be as we grow. And then a pop-up stand that we would put outside of the train station is $670. Based off of the $15 retail price of the Drinkster, our revenue in year one would be $233,000 about. And then after all of those numbers I just talked to, as well as other expenses at the bottom, such as a design patent and other trademarks, our net income would be $104,000. Year two and year three, we're planning with our aggressive social media campaign and using humor and targeting more Chicagoland people, especially since we were thinking of putting our logo on the Drinkster itself, so people will be advertising our product just by drinking out of it, and there's always people on the train who are looking at what other people are doing, so they'll see the little Drinkster logo. We feel that we can double in the first 2 years, so it would be about 15,000 Drinksters in year one, 30,000 in year two, and 60,000 in year three, which would bring our revenues to that. And then since the manufacturing costs will go down, our net income will go up in proportion to that. Further sources of revenue that we're looking towards is promotional branding. We actually got some of these ideas yesterday when we were presenting with the board members. So if we do decide to bring the idea to Starbucks, we can get Starbucks logo on there next to ours. We can go to Dunkin' and get their logo next to theirs. We'd be able to sell it in their stores. Also, you have a black Drinkster in front of you. We could look to expand it to different colors as well. Maybe have more feminine or one with flowers on it or different designs. And then we can also look into the Drinkster Premium, which might fit even larger things that our drink doesn't expand to and covers the bottom and might even keep the drink hotter and colder for longer. Finally, our ask is about $30,000 for 20%. And so from that, your return on investment from that initial would be about $161,000 in year three, which is 5.4 times in 3 years, plus 20% sale on the company, which leads to our exit strategy, which our five-year plan would be to build up the company value and exit and sell to a competitor, such as the Yeti or someone with a similar idea and something that they can utilize our product within their line.
Thank you. Keep your drinks hot or cold on the go with the Drinkster. Thank you.
How effective is that product compared to the competition? So you showed about a 13%, it kept it 13% cooler or hotter, respectively.
Right, so the prototype that we have right now, we were aiming to prove the concept and prove that our slaves actually work. And it kept it from cooling 13% each minute, which is not nearly as good as a Yeti would be right now. But since we have proved our concept, we're looking to expand our design, rework our design. This is our third design actually right now, and they get better each time, so we just keep cracking away at it.
Can you tell me how you think you want to reach the Starbucks customer or the Dunkin' Donuts customer? I mean, do you stand outside next to the cars and see if they want to buy one, or how are you going to reach those people specifically?
So our main idea was really people who take the train, because you have no source of reheating your drink, so there's no microwave on the train, obviously. And then also, if we are outside the train station, people always have to get there early to wait for the train. We wouldn't necessarily go outside the Starbucks or Dunkin' themselves, just because they might get a little upset if we're trying to sell a product right outside their store that's trying to sell a product. But if we go to the train station, we kind of do have people trapped in that little area, and then with our pop-up stand, we can sort of put up some of our ideas and everything and talk to them there. And then we could also physically get on the train themselves if we really want to trap them in and be able to give them our elevator pitch and sell our product.
Great job, guys. First of all, really good job with your pitch. Did you do any testing on the Joe jacket, I think you called it?
We did not. And then they do use a neoprene. So theoretically, the aerogel, like we said, is a NASA grade insulation. Neoprene is, they sell their product for $6, so it is a cheaper product. Right now, I would probably assume their product might insulate a little bit better, but as we do further development, we could definitely get ours to be premium.
And the goal of the Joe jacket is not to insulate your drink, it's to just put flowers on your cup or lightning bolt or whatever you might want.
Yeah, they advertise the neoprene as a little extra add-on.
And did you guys figure out how much a patent might cost for your product?
Oh, that was in the other expenses. I think design patent was around $1,320 for, I'm not sure how long it would last, however. It's not a good one. I'm not sure. If they gave you an investment packets, it would be up there.
Did you give any thought to because you're all, three of you are going away to college?
Yes.
Did you give any thought to selling it to a channel? Like going and selling it wholesale to a wholesale group or to a group that sells to Starbucks?
Yes, but I think that's what we were trying to get into. I mean, because it would be hard. We did factor in salaries if we did want to physically sell it ourselves. But the other thing that we could do, I suppose, is instead of us putting the logo on the Starbucks, actually going to the wholesaler and having them sell the product to Starbucks for us.
Less margin, bigger volume.
Yeah.
Did you guys survey price tolerance at all? So when you got the feedback from customers, did they give you an indication of what they're willing to pay?
Yeah, so at the beginning of the year, we put out a bunch of surveys. I think we got about 130 responses, and we put, what would you be willing to pay for the Drinkster at the bottom, and the price was ranging between $10 and $20, so right now we're at in the middle of that at $15, and we aim to lower that as our cost lowers as well.
Dollar Shave Club, like, has kind of paved the path for you, right? I mean, they innovated a razor in a super competitive space, and they did it with humor. So I think, you know, you guys are on to something with the idea. It's great.
Is it washable?
I'm not sure, but Matt's telling me it is.
Yeah, so the elastic band around the outside, you can wipe it off. We tried this. We spilled some milk on it and tried it and wiped it off. And the inside is lined with aerogel, and we wrapped Mylar around that. Now, the one you have over there, it's not, but our future design is going to have Mylar wrapped around the aerogel. And so the water or like whatever you spill will not be able to get to the heart of it, which is the aerogel. And so the elastic is cleanable, yes.
Thank you for your time.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, great job, Drinkster. We have some quick elevator pitches that we're going to do here in just a second. Before we do that, we want to thank one more person, and this Miss Usha Ipe, she probably won't stand up, but maybe she'll wave. Miss Usha Ipe is an entrepreneur teacher at Edison, and she's done a great job of encouraging her students. We're super excited to have our middle school friends here presenting with us tonight. They're going to give us an elevator pitch. They've got a big presentation on Friday, and these are entrepreneurs of the future. They're the future incubator students, so we're real, real excited to have those folks with us. So let's hear from Beauty, Kalor, Alexa, and Bailey. Come on up.
According to Epidemic Emergency Medicine, there were an estimated 105,000 hair care product-related injuries in the five-year period, of which 82,000, 78%, involved a curling iron in 2001.
Our mission is to protect individual skin while using a heat styling tool. In 6 months, we'll have sold over 100 headbands in our bundle packaging, which will include heat-resistant gloves, and hair nutrient oils to protect your hair from damage.
We will achieve our goal by advertising and using word of mouth toward family and friends. In 4 to 5 years, we want our product to expand in the beauty industry. We also want our product to start being used in beauty salons and beauty stores.
We hope to gain 5% of the hair market in 10 years. Our target market, our target market ranges from Generation Z, age 14, to Generation X, age 53.
Our startup cost will be $500 just to get all of our supplies we need to make our product. We will start making our product in our garage garages until we will get the full fundraising to start manufacturing our product professionally.
We have a competitor called Love My Head and Neck Protector. They sell their product at $19.99 for shipping and handling. But Beauty Color will only, our retail cost will cost $12.99 for manufacturing and shipping. And we'd like to thank you guys all for listening and for this opportunity and your time. We greatly appreciate it. We hope one day we'll be a huge success.
Great job. Welcome, Beauty Color. All right, let's hear from our next medicine group. We've got Greener Life, Gwen and Caroline. Come on up.
Solve this problem and help reduce this problem as well. Our app is a recycling-based app to help spread awareness of recycling and help the Earth's well-being. And also, it encourages you to make your life greener. Many people that encourage recycling also don't know what to recycle, which is a major problem. We hope to improve the knowledge of recycling of many people and decrease many people's carbon footprint. We hope to teach what helps and hurts the Earth, and also learn ourselves what helps and hurts the Earth.
In the next few years, we hope to partner with other companies such as TerraCycle and to expand with new features like a barcode scanner. The industry size was $106 billion in 2015, and we have a many indirect competitors, and our target market is millennials, with both men and women living in cities and suburbs. Our marketing strategy is going to be using social media, flyers, word of mouth, and presentations. This is a screenshot of our prototype app, and our startup cost will be around $2,000 with essentials, a website, and advertising.
We hope to continue to work on this app. Currently, we are using a free app maker called AppyPie and would like to expand from that and also continue developing our app. If any of you are interested in helping us, we would greatly appreciate that. Thank you for taking the time to listen to our speech.
Great job, Greater Life. All right, thanks to our medicine groups. We'll hear from a couple others here tonight. Let's get our next high school team up. Next, we have Revitalize. Come on down.
First off, thank you all for coming. Now, by show of hands, how many of you drink coffee? Almost everyone, right? Now, Mr. Traxinger, how much coffee would you say you have per day?
Couple cups.
Well, for those of you that may not already know, coffee causes your body to become dehydrated. And when you're dehydrated, you can't perform to the best of your ability. I'm Parker Robinson.
I'm Jack Kelly.
I'm Miles Mackey.
I'm Flora Brady.
And I'm Mia Savicevich.
We are Revitalized. Now this is Sarah. Sarah is a mother of three children, has a full-time job, and tries to work out 7 days a week. She's constantly on the go, moving back and forth to and from different activities. She wouldn't be able to accomplish this without the help of one essential nutrient, one nutrient that allows our minds and bodies to refuel, recharge, and take on these different tasks. However, we oftentimes take this for granted, and that essential nutrient is water. At Revitalize, we like to focus on the problem of hydration, or lack thereof. Dehydration is a preventable condition that affects many people. In fact, just this past weekend, NBA legend Bill Russell was hospitalized due to dehydration. Now, Mr. Haas, do you know off the top of your head how many people work in your company?
Yeah,
150. 150? Can you imagine that 75% of those 150 workers are not performing to their maximum potential for something as simple as hydrating? Now, you may not have noticed already, but only three of the Sharks have received water bottles. That was no accident. That was to represent the six people that didn't have water bottles were to represent the people that are dehydrated, while the three people with water bottles were to represent those who are properly hydrated. Well, at Revitalize, we feel like we have come up with the ultimate solution to solve the problem of dehydration.
And we found the solution to this problem. We've created the Revitalize app. It allows you to input specialized data like your height and weight and the time you get up in the morning and the time you go to sleep at night. And it will create intervals and alert you on your phone when you need to drink to help you to reach your hydration goal. We've changed our target market from hospitals and doctors to the fitness market and athletes. Initially, we started off by focusing on the water bottle attachment, and then we realized that we were not taking advantage of the resources we had at school, so we decided to focus on the app to create a customer base that were ready and willing to try out our water bottle attachment once it was developed. This is the progress we've made since our pivot.
All right, so this is the homepage of our app. This is loading screen. So as you can see, it has our name, logo, and our say, improving your hydration one drop at a time. So once it's done loading, it'll bring you to this pop-up and it asks you for your wake-up time. This time will serve as the beginning of your schedule. So if you go ahead and hit OK, we'll set our time. We set ours to 8 o'clock. And so it'll bring you back to this beginning page, and it has the show schedule option, our logo, and the goal amount of the amount of water you need to drink right at the bottom. So in the bottom right-hand corner, we're going to go ahead and click on the profile, and it'll ask us to enter our bedtime. And this will be the end of our schedule. So we set ours at 11:30. Just go ahead and hit done, and it'll bring you to this profile page. So at the top, it has the profile with our name, weight, activity level, and bedtime. At the bottom, there are links to our website and our Instagram and Twitter as well. So let's go ahead and fill this out. So we'll go and click on name, and we did Mr. J. Haas, and we'll go ahead and hit done. And then we'll go ahead and fill out the weight. We did 160 pounds, and we apologize for the sign. So we go ahead and hit done, and next we're filling out the activity level, and we did 60 minutes, and on a scale of 1 through 5, 5 being working out the hardest, we chose number 4, and hit done, and then if you go to the bottom left-hand corner and click on the schedule, it'll bring you back, and if you've noticed, the goal on the bottom has updated to match the personal profile. If you want to see the times you should be drinking, you go ahead and click on the show schedule option up at the top, and it'll show you the intervals. Now if you swipe left or right, it'll bring you right back to the beginning. And this droplet you see on the inside fills up each time you drink water, or you can manually push the logo itself and the water droplet will grow in size. And with that, we would like to thank Mrs. Phelan as well as Austin Wesker for helping the development of our app.
For our company, we've chosen four main sources of revenue, the first being our app, and this is just what we're going to start off with, and the way we'll make money off of our app is simply advertising space in the form of banners on top and bottom of our app, which we will sell to any company that's interested. The second is advertisements. Not only is our app a good place for advertising, but we have a social media, including Instagram and Twitter, as well as a developed website that we've launched. So we'd like to provide advertising space on all three of those platforms. Third, we'd like to partner with local businesses such as gyms. So, for instance, a gym would offer a premium membership, and as part of the signing deal, we'd throw in a free attachment, and then they would download the app subsequently. And then finally, and most importantly, our attachment. And what this is an attachment on water bottles. And why it's important is we didn't have enough initial funding to develop this attachment, so we are using the app, advertisements, and partnerships to reach this goal of developing the attachment. So on this topic, there's a 12% increase from 2016 to 2019 mobile advertising marketing. And the reason this is important is since we are trying to develop and come to towards our attachment, we'd like to ride the wave of this steady increase in advertising through apps. Also, along with this, mobile internet ad spending, such as our website, has increased from around 20 billion to just under 200 billion in the US from the time span 2013 to year 2019. And digital ad spending, such as our Instagram and Twitter, has also increased steadily from about a little under 5% to a little under 30%.
So this is the market, going over the costs and the revenue that we can generate with just the attachment. So at the beginning of the year, we thought we would go after the hospital market, but as we continued to do research, we found that we had more potential in the fitness industry. And this is because people are already looking for new and practical ways to improve their fitness and overall well-being. So if we take the number of gym memberships as of 2016 at 57.25 million, and we sell to 100% of them at $40 per attachment, this brings us to a total addressable market revenue of $2.29 million. And at the bottom here, you see our five-year growth plan at 2%. And we did this based off of a year-to-year average from the years 2010 to 2016. So let's scale it down a bit. There are approximately 20 gyms in the Wheaton area. So that brings us a total estimated number of SAM customers at 31,336. And if we sell to 100% of them at $40, this brings us to a SAM revenue of $1.25 million. And if we sell to just 15% of our SAM customers, this brings us to a total market share revenue of $188,000. So what do the profits look like? Well, as I mentioned earlier, we plan on selling our product at $40. And this is because we found that the average person spends around $35 on health and fitness accessories. This has also helped overcome the cost of goods sold, which, as you can see, is pretty high at $27.32. Mind you, this is a super high estimate because this is based off buying components from other companies at their prices and at single unit prices. Even so, we still maintain a 31.7% profit margins. But with your help, we know that we can bring this cost of goods sold down, increase our profit margins. Ultimately, this will allow us to sell to gyms and fitness centers in bulk, which will allow them to offer our attachment as an incentive for their premium memberships.
Now, to reach our maximum potential as a company, we need your financial assistance and resources to further develop our business. And with your help, we can further the development of our app by making it more user-friendly and more effective. And as you've seen earlier in our presentation, our app is not up to its full potential. We need better technology and a more appealing design. And that will cost around $2,000. And along with our app development, we need around $4,000 for the research and development for our water bottle attachment, which is the Vitalizer. And that's our second phase of our company. And we wanted to focus on the first phase of our company, which is the app. And we will need around $4,000 for the research and development. And for marketing, we need around $1,500 to market via fitness centers, gyms, and athletes. And that will help us through marketing via the fitness centers, health clubs, and gyms. That will help us get feedback from our app, which will then progress us into the second stage of our company. And with a business comes unexpected costs, and we know that the bumps in the road and any costs that may come up, we need to be prepared. So we want a $1,300 liquidity cushion for that. And with that, we need your help, and we're asking for a $10,000 investment for 10% equity in our company. So why should you invest in Revitalize? Well, there are many reasons, and the first reason is because of our market growth. Every year, the number of gym memberships increases by 4%, and that will help our company grow in terms of sales and increased revenue, not to mention a great return on investment as well. And our second reason why you should invest in us is because we are a cohesive team that works exceptionally well together. We are highly invested in the progression and success of our company. And with your help, we can become an even greater company. And the third reason you should invest in Revitalize is because we care about our customers. We We take it to heart that many people are suffering from the problem of forgetting to drink water, but we also recognize that there are people out there that don't even have the problem of forgetting to stay hydrated because they can't. And so hopefully later on in our journey, we want to partner and donate a portion of our profit to a charity that can help these countries get the water that they don't have. And the fourth reason why you should invest in us is because of our passion for solving this problem. Think about the benefits that come from a re-energized, fully hydrated, and healthier society. And last but not least, you should invest in Revitalize because of how prevalent this problem is in the United States. As we stated earlier, there are 75% of Americans that are dehydrated, simply because they are unaware of how much water they should be drinking on a daily basis. And if we can help solve this problem, not only is that an incredible opportunity for monetization, but more importantly, it's an incredible opportunity to fulfill our mission of decreasing dehydration. And in conclusion, as you've heard before, the problem of dehydration is a prevalent problem, and it affects many people. And it is essential that we get the proper amount of hydration per day. And with our app, we can help solve this problem by offering a personalized hydration schedule that is customized for your hydration needs that will help you stay reminded and hydrated throughout the day. And with that, we need your help, and we're asking for a $10,000 investment for 10% in our company.
So at Revitalize, we focus on the ability of individuals to reach their maximum potential, but we can only do that through proper hydration. So help us hydrate the world one drop at a time. Thank you.
Great job. So just to be clear, so there's kind of two components, right? There is an app that with ads is free, without ads is 99 cents. And then there's the Vitalizer, which is the attachment, which you sell for $40. So number one, what technology would that link up with the app? Would be Bluetooth, things like this. Second of all, competitors that you've seen in that space.
Yes, so we have two components for monetization. So we have the attachment itself, $40, like we said earlier, and this actually syncs with the app. So the app is where you create the profile and the schedule, and then that syncs with the app to make sure that, or it syncs with the attachment, so the attachment lights up at the correct times. For competitors, we tested out a competitor called Dagula, and this is a water bottle attachment as well, but we found that it was difficult to actually be reminded because of the light on it was quite dim, and we don't always have our water bottles on us at all times, so we figured that with an app you can always be reminded on a smartwatch or your phone itself. And then if you have your water bottle on you, that's always a great tool if you're looking over at that drinking water.
First off, really nice job. Love the use of kind of a persona on the front end. I thought that really helped make it more personal and who you were targeting and talking to. You mentioned selling ad space on your website as one of your revenue streams. So what is it that's going to drive people to keep coming back to your website? Are you guys, it's an app, right? So you're running things through the app, so ad space there makes total sense. But can you help me understand how that would work with the site?
Yeah, so our website was actually our MVP. We decided to go with the smoke test, and basically we set it up in order to attract attention to our company. And with all the products that we're going to release, our app, social media, any type of marketing, we always want to direct it back to our website. That's going to be our home base, so to say, for all shipments, for all transactions, and also links to the app and social media accounts. So with everything that we have through our apps and through marketing and social media, we want it all to trace back to our website in order to bring everyone, like all of our customers, to one place that they can get all their information from.
You guys showed projections of about $2.3 billion addressable market, so I love the fact that you went so bold. But then in year two, you showed the same amount with, I think, a 4% growth. So that kind of told me that the device only lasted a year. People had to buy it every year. Is that what your expectation is?
Yeah, so the reason our total addressable market customer is enormous is because there are the 57.25 million memberships, and that's assuming we sell to 100% of them. But then, yeah, as you stated, we ideally would like to come out with new updates on the attachment itself, so new functions, and creating a better way to be reminded. So ideally, they would be coming back every year. And we know that gym memberships, they're going to have to be renewed as well. And, gyms are going to be buying our product in bulk as well, so they're going to have to refill their stock once in a while. So that's what we accounted for, as for them buying multiple times.
What's the single best insight you got in terms of customer feedback or early adopter feedback, if you had to narrow it down to just one thing?
Well, with our product and our app, the one thing that separates us from our competition is that it's personal. So, like at the beginning, we like to identify our specific customers, and we want it to all revolve around them. With our competitors, their products were all just based on a certain time interval to remind you to drink. With our product, we want it to be customizable so you create your own tracking schedule for hydration, because everyone's at a different level physically, everyone has different hydration needs. So a lot of our early adopters really liked the idea of it being customizable for them, because they felt, instead, unlike the competitors, that they really felt it was their own hydration tracking schedule rather than some set time interval. Thank you for your time.
All right, great job, Revitalize. So our sharks have a lot to think about, so we're going to give them some time to kind of debrief after the first three presentations. We'll excuse them. This is a good chance for you to get up and visit the Student Excellence Foundation table. There's also a photo station there if you want to take a picture with your team or with the folks you came with. So we'll take a break for about 10 minutes, and then we'll come on back in.